Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Oh, it is a beautiful sight. All these happy, shiny people, new faces, and old friends returning. It's so wonderful to see you all. I'm Reverend Cindy Grimes, and I am the senior minister here. Some of you might not know that if you came last week, because I wasn't here. Mm-hmm. You had a visiting minister. Hope you all enjoyed Reverend Patricia.
Woo-hoo!
It was wonderful, and Patricia gave me an opportunity to be at the River Phoenix Center for Peace Building all week. 6 days I was at a training last week, so it wasn't all, it wasn't all vacation. But I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. So, for the past month, we've been talking about risks, but before that, we were talking about our dreams. How many of you feel like you have dreams for your life still? Yes?
Ain't dead yet.
I hope you all have hopes and dreams for your lives. It's amazing how many people don't have them, really and truly, even young people, even kids. I've done workshops with young people for years, and it's one of the cornerstone workshops that I do starts out with having a vision for your life, and to ask kids at 13 and 14 what their dreams are, and for them to say, I don't have any, it's really kind of sad. So I'm glad that we're in a group where people can still see possibility and still feel like they're in touch with their dreams. So we've been talking about having a dream, number one, and then this month is all about taking those risks that will bring you closer to your dreams. So last time I was here, I spoke about the end game. You know, we all know that we all have an expiration date. Right? We don't call it that for ourselves, but it is true. There is one day that you will expire for the very last time, each one of us. It's one thing that we all have in common. So I thought it would be wise for us to talk about what do people at the end of life have to teach us about what's important. And I've been a hospice social worker for several years, and thank goodness for me, it happened when I was a very young person, so I could start to incorporate some of those ideas into my own life. So that I wouldn't be on my deathbed at some point having all kinds of regrets, you know, wishing that it had been a different way or that I could have made more of the life that I had. And I think those are very valuable lessons. Does anyone else agree with that?
Yes.
So we talked about what are the regrets of people that are in those last days. And this quote kind of sums it up. There were 5 points that I got from a book. But in the end, we regret more the chances that we didn't take. It's not the things that we did that didn't go well, but the chances that we didn't take. The relationships we were afraid to have, and the decisions we waited too long to make. How many of you can see that already?
Yeah.
I think, why did I wait so long to do this? Why didn't I step out and try that? Why did I play it safe? Safety is an illusion, you know. So, and then I talked about Henry David Thoreau. I love this quote from Thoreau. How many of you know Henry David Thoreau? He spent 2 years, 2 months, 2 days in this cabin that's actually on the cover of that book, Walden. And he said through that experiment that he had learned that if one advances confidently in the direction of their dreams and endeavors to live the life they imagine, they will meet with success unexpected in common hours. I love that. If you have the faith and step out into the possibility without fear, with confidence, then the universe is going to rise up to support you in that because of that faith. He will put some things behind, will pass an invisible boundary where new universal and more liberal laws will begin to establish themselves around and within him, where the old laws will be expanded and interpreted in his favor in a more liberal sense, and he will then live with the license a higher order of beings. The universe does indeed conspire on our behalf when we do our part, when we step out, when we take those risks. Right? But risking is a little scary, isn't it? That's why we call it risk. Because risk implies that there's some kind of danger. There's some kind of danger. However, well, let me back that up. We're not here to play it safe, right? Because we do indeed all have that expiration date. No amount of playing it safe is going to extend that time for you. That's my perspective anyway. You know, when it's your time to go, nothing is going to keep you here Nothing is going to take you sooner. Nothing is going to leave you here longer. When it's your time, it's your time.
That's kind of my perspective.
A recycling day? We can call it that. Sure, we can call it a recycling day. I like that. So, as Thoreau says, when the person moves forward in the direction of their dreams, right, that implies that you have a dream in place, that you know what it is, so that you can move forward into that.
Yes.
Right? Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So now I'm going backwards now. Okay. Try it again. So the direction is very important. You want to have some kind of a destination in mind. Though we know, you know, as the song just said, it really isn't about the destination. It's about the climb. It's about the process of getting there. The destination is certainly a piece of that, but it is not the end all. Right? You want to enjoy the process as you're getting to that destination. But you want to have one in mind. You want to have an idea where you're going. Right? No wind is favorable to the sailor with no destination in mind. If you have no destination, it's kind of like getting in your car in the morning and saying, take me someplace.
Okay.
Right? You have the vehicle to get wherever you want, but it's not going to take you on its own. You have to have an idea where you're going. Now, you could be like the feather going with the wind, you know, wherever life takes you, and that's fine. That's fine, and many of us live that way, very, very beautiful lives that way. But if your life isn't exactly what you want it to be, if you're feeling like there may be something more, if there is something that is in your heart that you feel is yours to do, then by all means, that's what you need to be doing. You need to be moving in that direction. So the question that comes up for me that is, I know what happened. I left out the slide. I had a little techie glitch this morning. So I did want to tell you a little bit about what I did this past week. It was at the River Phoenix Center for Peace Building. Now, some of you know that name, River Phoenix?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So River Phoenix was a young actor who died in the 90s of, I believe it was a drug overdose. Accidental drug overdose, but at any rate, he was a peace activist essentially, and wanted to establish a foundation and to do all kinds of charitable things, and his life was cut short, and his mother then took on the work that he started, and 5 years ago she established what she called the River Phoenix Center for Peace Building, and unfortunately the slide that's missing here is the slide that has their mission and their vision and the information about them. But essentially what they do at the River Phoenix Center for Peace Building is they go through the whole spectrum of what it is to create peace in communities, starting with us as individuals. It's a huge, huge undertaking. And they come at it from the perspective that we share, that all of life is sacred. And that we are all expressions of the divine, though they may not say it in quite those words, because it's a secular organization. But they come from that perspective, that we are all one. And it's about teaching people social and emotional intelligence. They teach conflict resolution. They teach a practice called restorative justice, which is actually what was used in South Africa to end apartheid. It is a way for people who have been hurt and for people who have hurt others to come together in a circle and to be able to speak their truth about what happened, about what the impact was on their lives, about how that pain can be mitigated, or there could be some kind of accountability or something, some efforts to make things right. And then how can we prevent this from happening again? I felt it was no mistake that I was going to this workshop for 6 days after we had a school shooting here at Forest High School. And thank God, and we have some kids here that go to Forest. We have parents that were affected. Everybody, our whole community was affected by this. And thank goodness, you know, there was not more damage done than there was. But I'm still always left with the wondering and the desire to empower young people. It seems that there is an epidemic of hopelessness You know, why else would someone go into a school like that? Why do we have kids that feel like they have to go to those measures to be heard and to be understood and to get help? Mm-hmm. Right? What can we be doing as a community to instill some hope, to instill a feeling of connection where kids don't have to come out to cry out in these very desperate and dangerous ways? So here I was in this workshop for 6 days with Jesse Miller. Raise your hand back there. Jesse and I have been on this road together for a while. And for part of it with a dozen other people, and then for the next part of it, we were with some other folks from not just Gainesville, but actually all over Florida, and there were even three people that came from Norway that were there for the third time, getting the tools and the information they need so they could start a peace-building center in Norway. So it was a phenomenal week. It was a roller coaster of emotions and very, very inspiring. And so my question right from the beginning, because again, this task of peace-building, even within ourselves, can feel huge. But now you're just talking about putting it out in the community and nations and world peace. It's overwhelming. Like, where do you start? Where do you start with something like that? So my question from the very beginning, and they wanted to know, what is your intention in being here? My intention was to find out, what is mine to do in all of this? Can anyone relate to that?
Yeah.
The questions we ask, what's mine to do? Right? You may have these big dreams. You may have these big hopes. You may have these things that you want to do that just seem so huge. Like, what is my place in all of that? So that's the first question. What's mine to do? And here's the other question in terms of dream building that you might ask yourself. Most of us, when we have a dream, we think, am I worthy of that dream? Am I worthy to be a peace builder, to help bring peace into my own community, to be maybe a world peace builder? Am I worthy of that? You might wonder that to yourself. But the question really needs to be, is that dream worthy of you? Is the dream that you're looking at, is it worthy of your life energy? Is it worthy of your time? You know, because you have this life, right? So think about your dreams. You may have, and everybody's dreams are different. You know, we're not here to judge what somebody's dream is because we're all unique individuals. You know, we all have different dreams. Somebody's dream may not be as huge as, you know, building world peace or peace in their community. Their dream might be to be the first person in their family to go to college. Right? Their dream might be to have a family, you know, that you know, maybe was better than the family that they grew up in. You know, maybe that their children would not have to suffer or go through things that they went through as a child. That could be a person's dream. You know, maybe their dream is to really enjoy their grandchildren, to have that opportunity, right? to be with those babies, you know, and to have the time freedom to do that. That's a legitimate dream, just as legitimate as bringing peace or whatever other dream you may have. But is the dream worthy of you? That's the question. You know, there are some people, maybe they have a dream of, I want to be rich and famous. Okay, that's good. You know, and you might spend a whole lot of time doing that and get to that point and say, wow, this isn't all that I thought it was. It was going to be. So think about how you are spending your time and how you're spending your life energy and your life force. Is the dream, is the goal that you're looking at worthy of you? So there's a way that you can know this, that you can test your dream. And a lot of this information actually comes from a woman named Mary Morrissey, who has written several books and has done workshops and training on dream building. And so I've taken some of Mary's stuff and adapted it for our purposes here this morning. So if you want to know, you want to inquire about that, is this dream, is this really mine to do? Is this dream worthy of me? Right? The first thing you want to ask, does this thing make me feel alive? Mm-hmm. Right? Does it bring me to life? Yeah. Am I excited to get up in the morning because I get to do what I do, right? I get excited in the morning. Sometimes it feels like nerves, sometimes it feels scary, but I just kind of do that little twist. You know, I'm excited to start my day.
And I know that you all are going to be here waiting, so I'm hoping some people are going to show up. Maybe someone wants to hear what I have to say. But it feels exciting. It feels exhilarating. It's fun. And isn't that how you want to spend your time? Right? To be in a space of excitement and anticipation of what's ahead of you. Right? So does your dream make you feel alive? Does it give you juice? Does it bring you joy? And if it doesn't, maybe it's not. Maybe it's not the thing for you. Number two, does it align with my core values? Right? What does that require? It requires your core values. It requires that you know what is important for you. What do you value? Not what did your spouse value, or your boss, or your parents when you were growing up, or anybody else. It's what is important to you. And does your dream align with your values? Because it's your life that you're living, not somebody else's. So it has to line up for you. Right? You need to know, is your core value, is it family? Is that what's at the top of your list? Is it your integrity? Is it that you get to live authentically? Yeah. Know what your values are. And there are lots of lists. If anybody is interested, has not done this work, I can get you a list. There are exercises that you can do where you actually put them in order. And know, this is the most important thing for me. Right? So know what your values are. Test your dream. Does it align with your values? People may spend their whole lives climbing the ladder of success, only to find that once they reach the top, that ladder's leaning against the wrong wall. Wouldn't that suck?
So bad.
It does. And it happens to people. It happens to people. We see it all the time with celebrities. Right? People who think they want fame and fortune, and that's what they're going for. And then what happens? They get it. Right? People know who they are. They've got all the money in the world. And guess what?
They can't go anywhere.
Life still sucks. Because the money didn't give them what they thought it was going to give them. The fame didn't give them what they thought it was going to give them. And they're still miserable. And they spent all that time, they wasted their life energy with the ladder, climbing that ladder that was up against the wrong wall. Right? How many of us think, I'll be happy when? I'll be happy when I get that relationship. I'll be happy when I have a kid. I was just talking to a friend who had some plastic surgery. I'll be happy when I have boobs. Guess what? She got them, spent a whole lot of money, went through a whole lot of pain, and she's like, wow, I still really kind of feel the same. Yeah, this is what we do. But you have to know, by knowing your values, you can bypass some of that for yourself, that pain and that extra expense, thinking, oh, I'll be happy when I get this degree. Right? Then you get the degree. That's another person I knew, a physician. She spent a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of life force, because her parents wanted her to be a doctor. She wanted to be an opera singer. She was miserable. And then what do you have to do to just put in all that time and effort and energy climbing that ladder, only to find out, oh my gosh, this is not what I wanted. This is not what I thought it was going to be. Yikes. So get in touch with your values and what is important for you. And even do that little exercise where you put them in order so you know this is the most important thing for me. Testing your dream. Will it require you to grow? There's that. If your dreams don't scare you, they're too small.
Amen.
See, and there's a distinction now between goals and dreams. Because goals are the things that you can set and say, all right, I want to lose 50 pounds. You have a goal, you put a date to it, you can read books and know how you're going to do it, and you accomplish it. When you have a dream, you have no idea how you're going to get there. Right? It's going to require you to grow. It's going to require that you be different than who you are in this moment. That's part of what makes it a dream. That's part of what makes it so exciting. Is that you say, this is what calls me, this is what draws me. I have no idea how I'm going to get there, right? But it's so much a part of you that you can't not do it. And you know that you're going to be something different when you step into that. Is it going to require your growth? The next thing, number four, will it expand my faith? Will it expand my faith? Obviously, if you don't know how you're going to do it, it's got to expand your faith, right? Right? I'm looking at the possibilities now here of what would it be to have a peace center in Ocala? What would that look like? What do I need to be to empower that vision? Not just in our community, but in the larger community, right? What kind of collaborations does there need to be? Right? What do I have to do? What kind of leader do I need to be? And if I knew how to do it, if we knew how to do these things, they would already be done. I have to know, as Thoreau said, that when I step out in faith in that thing, you know, stepping out in faith, that the universe is going to conspire to give me what I need to make that happen. That's what faith is. That's what faith is. We walk by faith, not by sight. Right? So when we are in faith, we have the vision. We know what that vision is. You know, we can see it. And the people around you may not. Right? Your family may not be on it. Your friends, your coworkers, they're not seeing what you're seeing. And they may not see it till it's right in front of them. I had a dream years ago to start my own business. I started a parenting magazine. No one in my family had any business experience. My parents paid for me to go to college, you know, and then I quit my job and said, I'm going to stay home and start my own business. They were like, you're doing what? After we've spent all that money and all that time for you to go to school, you're going to stay home and do what?
They didn't get it. Degree.
And I didn't have, you're right, it was not a business degree that I had. And they didn't get it. For the longest time, they didn't get it. Until it was actually there. Here it is. And now, and they could see that other people bought into it, right? It became a networking thing. There were people who would stop me and say, I love that article you wrote, or people would write letters, and, you know, they got to see, wow, this is really something. Mm-hmm. Right? But if I had listened to the voices, what do you know about publishing? What do you know about having a magazine? What do you know about running your own business? I didn't know anything. I didn't know anything. All I had was a dream. All I had was an idea. All I had was an intention. I want to create something for our community that's going to empower parents. Mm-hmm. I want to give moms who are stay-at-home moms with their kids and not having adult contact with anyone to feel like they found a network of friends. And that's what the magazine was for.
We didn't have a bowl of money either.
And we did. You're right about that. We started on a shoestring. There was no money when we started that. Zero. All I had was an idea, you know, and maybe a little bit of talent, a little bit. But I also could talk to people, and I was able to share my vision for what this thing could be, and would you be interested in having that in this community? And that's what I had, you know, and the universe conspired on my behalf to bring different people into my life that could do the pieces that I didn't have any idea about. Jesse Miller was one of those people. So will it expand your faith? Is it going to require you to grow? Is it going to require that you step into something bigger that you may not even know yet? Yeah. Does it make your stomach kind of turn a little bit as you think about it? See, we're either affirming life or we're denying it. We are either accepting it or rejecting it. We can either have fear or we can have faith. You know, you can't be in both at the same time. You are in one or the other. It really is that simple. You can be in hope or despair. We can experience good or evil, love or hate. We can live in heaven or hell. How many of you know that's the truth?
Amen.
Right? We say spirituality, how does it go? Religion is for people afraid of going to hell. Spirituality is for people who've been there.
Yeah.
And most of us have been there, found our way out. You know, that's why we hang out here. So we can be in one or the other. In conversation, we are either saying yes or no to life.
I still have an apartment there.
I think you even visit on purpose sometimes.
I want to go see.
Yeah. Is it what you remember, and why were you staying away from that place? when we are turned to the light, all shadows are cast backwards. But when we turn from the light, the shadows are in front of us.
Yes.
I love that. And I've used this quote before. It's Ernest Holmes, who's the founder of this movement. Think about it. I'm facing the light now. Where is the shadow?
Mm-hmm.
It's behind me, right? I'm looking at the light. The shadow falls behind me. When I look at the shadow, the light's still there, but I'm not seeing it. Right? All I'm seeing is the dark there, the shadow.
Mm-hmm.
So we do one or the other. We are in faith or we are in fear. We are saying yes to life or we are saying no to life. Right? And when you look to the light, the shadows fall behind you. Remember that. The last question in testing your dream, is there some good for others in my dream? Is there some good for others in my dream? Goodness is the only investment that never fails. That brought us back to Thoreau. Love that. So you may have a dream. Maybe that dream is, and I'll use my husband's example, Brady, because the dream is, number one, was to be a dad. Right? That was the thing, too. I'm just going to tell your story a little bit. It's okay. I usually ask him ahead of time, but I mean, so my husband grew up without his father because his father died when Brady was just a year old. And I know that was his dream from when we met, that he was going to get to be a dad. That was his thing. You know, and is that selfish? Is that a selfish thing? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Some people might think, well, this dream feels like it's just for me. Somehow that makes it selfish. Is it not as worthy as bringing peace or whatever that is? You know, but my husband, through his example of being that amazing father that he didn't have, has then become an inspiration, an example to so many people around him. Not to mention our own kids.
And he's fathered other kids.
And he's fathered other kids.
At the center.
Figuratively.
Yes.
He's playing. That's good.
So yes, figuratively, he has been a father figure to many, many other people. And showing how it can be done really well. Really well. And now we have the opportunity to be grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Mm-hmm. And to see that. And so people get to see that. And we get to experience the joy of that. You know, and I always want to live my life in such a way, I say it all the time, and I'll use it, you know, where people are saying, I want whatever she's having.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I want to live in that way, right? I want to have some of that. I want to be that happy. I want to be that committed. I want to have that much passion in my life. I want to have that much joy. And I want for all of us to be that. You know, that's the best example you can give. Is you're out there living your life, and people are saying, what do you do? What is it that you believe? What are you following? Like, why is it possible for you to be happy in this circumstance? That's what I want for every one of us. For all the people in here, for the people that are watching, for everyone whose lives we touch, that everybody gets to live their lives in the way that brings them joy and happiness and excitement and has them feel like they gave it their all. Right, so when that day comes and you're looking back on your life, you can say for yourself, well done. Isn't that what we all want?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So is there some good in my dream for others? Maybe your dream is to find that loving relationship. And maybe that feels selfish for you. But the fact is, when people see true love, it inspires. Right? People say, I want some of that. So is there good for others in your dream? So what's mine to do? What's mine to do? If you're asking yourself that question as you look at your dreams, as you look at your desires of your heart, you know, how do I hold it down? What's mine? Is this mine? You ask yourself the questions, number one, does it make me feel alive? Does it bring me joy? Maybe it's not the way you make your living. You know, maybe you can't do that, but maybe you can take time a couple of times out of the week and devote it to your music or your artwork, or as my husband, I'll bring him up again now, playing tennis. He's taken up tennis now in his 50s and is really good at it. Is really good at it. To be an inspiration for our kids and for younger people to say, hey, you know, when you hit 50, it's not over, right? When you hit 60, 70, you know, there's always more. 80, there's 80. Always more. 80, yes, we keep going, right? There's always life. As long as you're here, you've got breath. You know, you've got the awareness. There is more you can do. You're here to enjoy this, to squeeze every ounce you can out of this thing called life. Does it make you feel alive? If you can say yes, it might be yours to do. Does it align with your core values? Right? Is it making you pick and choose? You know, Mary tells the story of a young woman who had a value. What she wanted to do was have adventure. She really wanted to have a great adventure. And she was a hairstylist, and she was tired of cutting hair, but she wanted to have this great adventure. Well, then a possibility comes up for her to cut hair, to be a hairstylist on a cruise ship. She would have this phenomenal adventure, like travel for a year. That was the contract for a whole year. And she would get to travel and see the world and have these wonderful adventures. Only problem was she had a year-old baby girl. And she didn't want to be gone for a year. You know how kids grow so fast, especially when they're so tiny. She was like feeling kind of conflicted because it felt like, okay, so here's an opportunity for me to cut hair. I'm going to get to have this great adventure. Her husband said, if this is what you want to do, hon, go for it. Now, that's some kind of husband to say that, right? You're going to be gone from our family for a year so you can have your adventure. Go for it. But it was feeling like, you know, a tough decision. Do I do it? Don't I? Do I follow what's for me? Do I do what's right for my family? Like, so Mary says, you know, when it's really yours to do, your values won't be in conflict, right? It's not going to require that you choose from your values. It is going to fulfill you within those values. Mm-hmm. So go home and think about this. Mm-hmm. And she did. And she realized, well, number one, I hate cutting hair. Why would I want to do that for another whole year? I'm trying to get out of this. I don't want to cut hair. Really, what this woman wanted to do, her adventure, was in learning. She really wanted to get her degree and become a teacher. She wanted to teach kindergarten. But when she was growing up, she was in a time where her family said, women don't go to college, you know, because you're just gonna have babies and it's going to be a waste of time and money, so we're not sending you to college. And she had some thoughts about her own self-worth. Was she smart enough? And all of that. But that really was her dream. That's what she wanted to do. So her adventure was in this stepping into to learning, to going to college, to this huge, what seemed like a huge, huge thing for her. But it's what she really wanted. So it's what she did. That's what she did. She quit that job that she hated. And she went back to school and she got her degree. And Mary talked about how beautiful it was to go the week that she started teaching, because she was teaching kindergarten and her own child was going to be in her class. Mm-hmm. Right. And it did not require that she compromise her values. She was able to satisfy that value of having adventure, of greater learning, but also of being with her family, because that was one of her values too. So your true dream, what is really yours to do, is not going to require that you choose among your values. It is going to allow you to honor all of them. Mm-hmm. But it means that you need to be clear on what that is. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it aligns with your values. Is it going to require that you grow into something new? That you be bigger, that you be stronger, that you be more settled, whatever that is. Is it going to require something more of you than where you are right now? And if it is going to require that you grow, if it is going to facilitate your growth, not only require it, but it's going to allow the way for you to be that person, you know, that you want to be, then maybe it's yours to do. Will it expand your faith? Do you already know how to do it? If you already know how you're going to do it, then maybe that's not really a dream. Maybe that's more of a goal. Because if it really is your dream, again, you probably don't know exactly how you're going to get there. You're just trusting that the universe is going to put the pieces in place for you to manifest that. But then you also have to take action on it. Right? It means that you also have to, when that step is revealed to you, that you take it. You take it. And you may not see what's coming after that. I think it's Martin Luther King that said that about the staircase, right? You take that first step. You may not see what's next, but once you get there, oh, that next step is revealed. And then you do what's next from that, and you step out there, and then the next step will be revealed. But that's what it requires when we step out in faith. Because it's not about what we can see with our eyes. It's about what we can know in our hearts, in our vision. Will it expand your faith? And then finally, is there good for others in this dream? Right? Is it going to enhance the lives of the people around you? Is it going to enhance? Is it going to do something for Mother Earth? Is it going to enhance your community? There's so many ways that we can look at that. Is there good for others in my dream? That's where the transcendence piece. If y'all remember. I know you know Maslow because I've talked about it so many times, right? That we've got those basic needs at the bottom of the pyramid. And then we've got, so your food, your shelter, your water. Well, now you want to be secure. I want to have a home. And now I want to have achievement and so on. And as we keep trying to work our way up, we're always coming from a place of not enough. Somehow I'm not enough. And if I just had another degree, right? If I just could have this relationship, right? Then I'll be enough. I'll be enough. And we know that it doesn't have to be that way. That we can go from that place of transcendence and knowing that we are part of something much larger. That there is something much bigger that is waiting to come and can only come through you. And when you dedicate yourself to giving that gift to the world, when you dedicate yourself to expressing that, then all the other stuff is meant for you. Right? Then you find your meaning. Then you find your joy. Then you're gonna have the money. Then you're gonna have the way to do what it is that you came here to do. Does all that make sense?
Yes.
All right. So I'm still working on this myself in terms of the peace building idea and what specifically is mine to do. You know, it's a big dream. It certainly is worthy. I feel like it's worthy of my time, of me. But is it mine? Is it our communities to do? Right? Because this certainly is not something that one person does. This has to be a community effort. So I'm going to take some time, and we'll talk about it some on Sundays, but I'm going to spend the next Wednesdays doing Soul to Soul, exploring some of these ideas and giving you all, for whoever wants to learn it, to know it, the tools that I was given and what I was taught, the social emotional learning, the conflict resolution. These are skills that we can use in any aspect of our lives. You know, it's not just for when a crime has been committed, but we had a gentleman who came from a school in a middle school in Orange County, yes, in Orlando. 2,400 kids in the school. And they have been doing these initiatives now for a few years?
Three years?
For 3 years they've been doing it. So the kids are now saying, when there's a problem in school, when somebody feels like they've been disrespected or a situation has come up, the kids will now get together and say to their teacher, we need to have a circle. We need a circle. So-and-so is not feeling good about this situation, and we need to talk it through, right? And it's an opportunity for people to speak what they need to speak, for accountability, and for new solutions, right? They call them, at the River Phoenix Center, they call themselves solutionaries. I said, we might borrow that. I don't know, solutionaries. And then I thought, well, maybe we could be possibilitarians. Let me call ourselves. You know, we're all about creating new possibilities for people. So maybe that's who we are. We're possibilitarians.
Yes.
So anyway, it works. This stuff works. I got myself sidetracked there. So anyway, they're using these processes. Discipline referrals have gone way down. You know, they're now looking like a model for the state, and people are asking, how are you doing this? How are you doing this? So in some regards, I was saying it felt like a big pie in the sky to think that we could have such a thing right here in Ocala. Mm-hmm. You know, but the other piece of that is that we take whatever we learn here through this process, if we take it on as a community, and how do we package that so that we can then offer it to other centers for spiritual living and say, this is how you get involved in your community. This is how you take a stand for oneness and inclusivity and peace. And these are the ways you can do it. Right? You know. So talk about hashtag 5,000. That's what we've been saying here, that's our vision, hashtag 5,000. If we do this, we're talking hashtag many more thousands. Right? The possibilities are tremendous. You know, and we can be part of that. One of the things that was kind of encouraging, it was a little double-edged for me at the training. There were two other ministers. One of them is no longer practicing. And the folks that were there had when people hear the title Reverend, there's a whole lot that goes with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes? Yeah. They make assumptions about who you are and what you're about. So there was a little bit of that. They were very wonderful, very opening, but I did have a little bit of that to contend with. And by the end of the training, I think they were very clear that I was not a typical or, you know, a traditional kind of a minister.
You're going to want an F-bomb, right?
And they were, there might have been one of those. They were very grateful. They were grateful to know that such an organization as this exists. Mm-hmm. Right? That there are people that are getting their spirituality, that are able to explore this part of their lives in the context of unity and inclusion and peace and acceptance.
Yes.
Right? Not trying to change people and have them be something else. Not trying to split that fair peg in the round hole. You know, that we can all be ourselves and belong just the way we are. Not trying to fit in and be something else, but to be who we are, to be part of the community. And they were very grateful and inspired to know that we exist. So now it's time to let people know in a bigger way.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
We're not for everybody. This peace building process maybe isn't for everybody either. You know, there are circumstances that happen, you know, in this restorative justice practice where you bring the person who did the harm and the one who was harmed together. And sometimes it is not appropriate to do that. Right? Everyone needs to be on the same page. Everyone needs to be willing. So the same is true for community, right? This may be the perfect thing for our community. Maybe it's just mine to do. Maybe it's part of the bigger community. I don't know that yet. But I invite you to explore it with me and see what is specifically yours to do within that, within the bigger context, but also within your own lives. What is mine to do? There are your five questions. Does it make me feel alive? Does it align with my core values? Does it facilitate my growth? Will it expand my faith? And is there good for others in my dream? And if you can say yes to all of those, then I would say proceed. And so it is.